Chasin the Racin, powered by Colchester Kawasaki. Part of the Global Moto Group, we supply new Aprilia, Moto Guzzi, Vespa, Royal Enfield, Kawasaki, Sim, Mutt, and Benelli motorcycles.
3, 2, 1, and welcome back to Chasin the Racin, episode 157. And we're down at Donington Park, round 3 BSB, straight after the Northwest. And we're delighted to be joined by a lot of people who have called you the man of the meeting. Davey Todd, how's it going?
All good, mate. Peaking to be here, to be honest, but still buzzing, I think, from the Northwest.
I'll tell you what, first of all, before we get going, shake my hand. What an outstanding bit of riding. That, like, I totally agree with you, Chrissy. That was man of the meeting. And before people think I'm just having a go because he's sitting here, but no, it's, mate, absolutely class, man. Absolutely class. It was just...
It was one of them where you were like the sort of nearly man in every class, but you were the only one that was right at the front in every class. So
that's what I've got to take from it, to be honest, because it is sickening. Like, you'll know yourself, like, second best every time, and you're like, I just wanted that win so bad. But yeah, to be there in every class and a couple of lap records and like. Yeah,
you didn't need to win. That was the thing about your performance at the Northwest, is you actually didn't need to win it. Everyone was like, bloody hell, and that is so good.
Did you get the lap record on the Stocker?
On the Stocker and the Supersport bike.
Supersport as well. And then Hickman got the outright one.
He got the outright one. We were so close because I actually went quicker than Glenn went, who beat me in the race. But Hickey used the softer option tyre. That's why his delaminated on lap 3. And we were on the hard tyre and we were like, a couple of tenths off. And
It turned into a bit of a shit fest in the end, but hopefully it'll just be kind of like a one-off, and it's a miracle that nothing serious happened.
It really was, mate. Like, how many issues, like four or five of us all had like big moments with the tire issues, and it was just one of those times where you got to thank your lucky stars that everybody got away from it. Nobody crashed.
Hold on, did McCormick have a crash in the chicane?
I don't think he crashed when his tire delaminated. No, he didn't crash.
He didn't crash.
It was down the straight. Mathers and McAvoy.
Have you heard anything from the tire manufacturer to like? Like why it possibly could have happened?
Yeah, so there's a manufacturing issue apparently that happened with the tire. It seems to come as a surprise to everyone, and Dom will tell you as much as anyone. Like, tires at the Northwest are always an issue. Like, it's nothing new. Like, it's only new to everybody who maybe hasn't been following the Northwest and stuff. But every time you get to the Northwest, the tires are falling to bits because it is just brutal. Like, flat out to basically a dead stop and then flat out again and dead stop and flat out. It just, the temperature of the tire goes through the roof, and all hard center tires, and I think you'd have to replace it with steel. Like, there's no way that you're getting rubber to last that long.
For people that don't know, it's actual engine braking, because like David says, you're going from like 200 mile an hour down to first gear, and the fact that the bike pitches that much and it's just coming back down in steady increments, and obviously at that pace I definitely don't feel it. You're a bit quicker than me, so but you don't really feel that jerd come back down. But
in all fairness though, it did your front tire as well, so that's got nothing to do with engine braking.
It did, but
we still don't really have an answer to that. It's a bit of a weird thing, and we're trying to get our head around it at Dunlop, working with Dunlop and speaking to them. And the only thing that we sort of come down to, which you don't know, but I ran off the track on lap 1 at the end of the back straight. I ran into that ditch at university and rode back out of that, and you know, you never know. It was long grass, and there could have been something in there, like you don't know, a bit of glass or anything stuck in the tire. And obviously I did 3 laps on it, but
it just got progressively worse. And
the first three laps were good, and that was where I like fought through. And then just I got into second place, the vibration started, but only on the brakes. So I'm like, it's warp brake disc, and it's probably easy to convince yourself that it's that at the time when you're trying to win a race. It's just warp disc, and it'd be all right. I'll keep second or something, or I'll keep pushing. And then steadily it was getting worse, and I was falling back. Which at the point you would think it's a road race, you really should pull in there. And I'm like, it's nearly the last lap. And then I seen the last lap flag and it's getting really bad at this point. Like the vibration is all the time. And I'm like, just one more lap, I'll just ride really slow. Because I had a really big gap to fifth place. I don't know. I just kept going. So
past where I was watching. So end of the straight just before university, I was just or like basically on the speed trap. So they used to be going through like 200 mile an hour. And from there, it just looked like a problem with the front mud. It looked like the front mudguard was loose. But Obviously I've seen the pictures afterwards and where it's like worn the front. But basically it was just like as you came past.
With all the tire, actually chunks of the tire, like sort of delaminate off. Coming out, I think that's what smashed all the mudguard up. And then obviously because of the vibration was that bad, it was like quite hard to hold on to the bars because it was vibrating so bad. So then I think that's why it was like shaking around, like you can see on the videos and stuff like that. It's shaking around a lot. And
I tell you what though, it's mental, but I think what we've got to be careful of is like the fact is that could happen to any tire manufacturer. I'm not trying to put the shits into everyone who rides a motorcycle, you know what I mean? But it's the fact of that could have happened to Pirelli, Metzeler, Michelin. That could have happened. But unfortunately, I tell you what, though, you wouldn't imagine being a fly on the wall at Dunlop on Monday morning. My giddy auntie. But like I say, it could happen to any tire. But I'm glad I went to Metzeler this year. That's all I'm saying.
Speaking of drama that day as well, and we're kind of really lucky to actually be doing this podcast in this studio, because as I was getting on the plane to come home, I'd actually left this trailer at my mate's yard, and
down south, mind.
And it was all down south. It was all locked. It was all locked up. Then big another metal barrier things that come out of the ground. As I was getting on the flight, like about 20 travellers turned up at the yard, got a big grinder, like a petrol grinder, just chopped the way into the yard. And so like as I was getting on the flight, I knew that there would be in this trailer. And like I was thinking, if they towed away, I'd be like completely screwed. Luckily, the police got there and a few of my mates got there and they left and left the trailer, but when I got down, it was literally just ransacked. Like every single thing was just pulled apart. There's just like shit everywhere, basically.
Luckily, they've
nicked two really stupid things. So like the black step to get in, they've nicked that.
If you're in a caravan, that's gold.
As we've just went to start this podcast, we've got like an extension socket which they've nicked as well, but.
It's a good time to bring in Malenko. Mr. Malenko here. I'm sure we can sort out a step for that. So make caravan steps, motorhome steps, stuff like that.
There you go, you see. Well, you kids. You're on commission.
I get one sorted out here.
They don't do pepper spray for pikeys, do they? You know what I mean? That's what we need. Like
padlocks as well. So maybe try some better padlocks. Malenko padlocks.
We're going to have to get like a Chasin the Racin and the dog. You know, we'll have to put the Patreon money up, Chrissy. We'll buy an Alsatian just to feed it like fresh meat so it just kills anything that comes through the door. But you can't rumble twice. You can't write it, can you?
Yeah, luckily, one thing I was worried about, I'd left 20 tickets for this round in this draw. And so I thought, obviously, they'll have gone. And when I came back, everything was scattered all over and the tickets were still there. So like that's obviously worth like hundreds and hundreds of pounds. So like that.
It's worth a lot to you, but it'd be pretty funny to see you nick it and then turn up. We've come for our hospitality.
I know, but
straight in the poor bird spot.
Yeah, it's one. it's one of them where just lucky to it got us thinking, do you know, in like other countries, like say, do you know your mate in America, where say in South Africa and America, where everyone's got guns, like the most like if you describe like how travelers live in the UK, they're like, it must be like a really weird concept to them, the fact people can just turn up at your property, break in, and then and just stay there, and the police can't move them. And do you know what I mean? It's like,
yeah, it must be wild for them, because they just be shot immediately. it's always funny, isn't it, when you see the signs out in America as like trespassers will be shot.
I mean, do they have
survivors will be shot again? Yeah, stuff like that. You know,
do they have travelers like around Europe? I know, Romania, Romanian gypsies.
I think so. In certain places, but
next week on the podcast, gypsy hunting.
They won't have them in America though, will they? Because like you say, everyone's not.
Surely not. But then I think I was expected a lot in Ireland, to expect a lot of travellers there. And it just doesn't happen really, because in a sense, nobody out there takes any shit. They're just like, you know what, like, get off my land, like, where everybody sort of,
I guarantee, I
tiptoes
know
where... around it here and doesn't allow it. I don't know.
I know what you mean, but there's guaranteed spot in the Isle of Man. They do not let it happen.
They don't have caravans.
No, you have to get permission from the government. Like, when we go racing, you need permission from the government to take your caravan. That's class, isn't it? You know what I mean? There's no messing about there, is there? Straight off the bat, you go.
Now, speaking, going back to the Northwest, so obviously you had like a real successful week. Alistair Seeley was also very impressive. Three more wins. It does take them to about 27.
27, I think it is, yeah.
Overall, which is like incredible in that. And and obviously Glenn also had a strong, he got two wins, didn't he?
Both Superbike races, yeah. Mm-hmm. So that's him, six in a row, seven in a row?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
The most in a row that anyone's ever won.
We'll just leave the Ibiza flight to fly over the top there. There you go, everyone's off on holiday. There you go. But talk us through that wet race. How much grip was there for you? Be honest. Because for me, everyone was going like that. You know when you watch the telly and when you watch the race and everyone's going, there's loads of grip, there's loads of grip. We've all wet raced. You two lads, you and Seeley, broke the pack. You went away and you had no lean angle, the pair of you, and you broke the pack. It just showed the lack of...
Honestly, I come in and I was like, that is the slippiest wet conditions I've ever rode in my life. Because you're in a straight line, and not even on a big bike, on a 600, you were spinning up in a straight line. Like, you're coming out the Mill Road roundabout, and that patch of new tarmac there, honestly, you couldn't accelerate. So you had to like accelerate just before it to push you onto it, as if you were like pushing yourself onto an ice skating rink, and then like be bolt upright and like hold a steady throttle, and even on a steady throttle it start to spin, and then you couldn't open the throttle again till you're off the other side of this patch. And it was like,
compared to 2019 when you won that 600 race in the wet conditions again, was it literally like night, like total different, or was it quite similar?
No, so it's really disappointing actually, in a sense, because the organizers of it and have done so much work at the track, retarmacking it, resurfacing so much of the course, so there's all this pristine, like you've seen, new tarmac everywhere, but in the wet it was brutal. Like in the wet you just had like 10 times less grip on all the new tarmac, and like maybe more than half of the track is new tarmac now.
Yeah,
so it was just lethal. And then you jumped off the 600 onto the big bike and you're like, man, it's raining heavier then. And
In the wet, which is the, I presume station must be quite scary in the wet.
Station was all right.
Station, weirdly enough, that was the station, and the back straight was actually like all old tarmac still. So that was actually not so bad.
Really?
It was all the like coast road and stuff like that where you're... Yeah,
is there anywhere on the lap that you get to and you just think, right, I just need to get through the like... Need just get through this corner and then I'll carry
in
on.
The wet, most of it, to be quite honest. In the wet, that coast road was pretty lethal, like up from Metropole right up under the bridge over Black Hill, all of that was lethal. That right before Black Hill, which there's always been a little bump on the inside.
I was going to ask you about this. Yeah,
they've re-tarmacked it, right? And it's like they've re-tarmacked a jump on the inside. They've made this bump like three times bigger.
I tell you what though, in your opinion, is that safer or not?
See, a few people said this, they're like, maybe it's safer because now you have to go slower through there.
Well, it's more apparent because a lot of people, like 2019...
I'm not sure I call it safer.
Well, no, it's safe. Well, it's a road race, that's a good thing. Yeah. You can always round it off to it's a road race. But like, beforehand, like 2019, you could go through on one line and think, oh, I made it through that time, and you come round, you like a couple of, like an inch off, it wants to fold the front, and it's caught out so many people that almost the inconsistency of the corner, that little bit more throttle coming out the turn, you're like, well, that's changed. But like you say, it's almost like a tabletop now. You're coming through and it made it consistent, which in essence made it more predictable. That kind of made it safer. Don't know.
I guess so, in a sense.
He set two lap records. That's why I'm asking him if it's safer. You know what I mean?
Like, it amazed me in that sense, because like a few areas you're like, didn't think it was necessarily better, but then obviously lap records were going, so must have been better than new timer. I don't know. But the weather was good, and a lot of played into it. The racing was tight, where like what Glenn said to me was like he's not really been pushed the last however many races he's had that he's won. He's broke the pack and then controlled it, so he's not had to
work.
He's not had to push for it. And he come in, he was like, "That's the hardest I've ever pushed around there." And you have to, when you're in a battle, you're battling with
someone.
Too
fair, had him into the common. You passed him going into the last chicane before the what's it called, the Metropole.
Yeah,
into there, and the commentators were going, "Oh, he's went too early. It's a mistake." And then you held on the inside, forcing him to the outside. And if you it just worked out where you went like a tiny bit and he got the cut back on you, but like that was millimeters away from. And if you'd held it there, I don't think there's not. I know people have.
Yeah, I was actually pretty strong over Black Hill and then breaking into Juniper.
Yeah.
So that's why I wanted to go at the front. I didn't want to leave it till then because I could never get the slipstream into Juniper on him, and he's good on the brakes as well. But we were pretty even, so if you didn't really have a run, it was hard.
It was over.
So.
And as go on.
I'll tell you what, like even the similar location, exactly the same place on the track, was the Lee Johnson moment as well. Because you must have watched it back, are you?
Yeah.
The footage and that. I honestly believe, right, if you didn't squeeze him there and if Lee got by, you would have won that race. No, I know that's the worst thing to tell you sitting here, but it's the fact is...
In a sense,
because he would have gauged it, and throughout that whole race, throughout of it, you were outbreaking Lee, and you're thinking he's so light, BSB, everything like that. You're thinking, my God. But if he gauged the brake, I genuinely believe you would have gone, put the gum shield in and gone for it, like 100%.
That I don't know. That's the sort of thing. I just thought I'd defended enough. I didn't want to go putting anyone in the curb, but it was mad looking from my onboard how it like blocks him off to the curb and he rolls off. And he rolls out of it, and then as much as everyone's going, "Oh, your bike's so much quicker than his," like he rolled off and then went and drove by me, and I was like, it caught me by surprise because he passed me where I didn't expect it. He passed me too early, for where I expect him to actually come by.
Because when's the first time you hopped on that? Because that's the new 600 from Honda, isn't it? Like, but you can't get them in this country. You have to get them from Japan, everything like directly from Honda. So when you tested that bike, was it with just kind of no reference to any other power, no nothing?
No, nothing. So we did a bit of a secret sort of thing. We didn't say nothing about it just after the press launch in the Isle of Man. We stayed over for an extra couple of days and went to Jerby. It was a pretty good idea because they came around to it and they're like, "Yeah, it's not the best track," but they're like, "You know what? It's really bumpy, got potholes, it's rough, it's got a long back straight that is rough as anything." So like, it's probably a good gauge for a road race bike. So we just went there for a couple of days on the 600 and the Super bike and give it a test round there. And first time I hopped on it, to be honest, I was just like, mint, okay, like, let's go. Like, I just felt happy.
So when you pulled up, like, and you got into race mode, you know what I mean? Like, because practice, you kind of think, well, people are really pushing. But in race mode, you must have just gone, holy shit, this thing's quick. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Was it a shock for you?
Yeah.
How quick it was?
It wasn't, you know, like, to be honest, I know the team and we used to, I've rode for Padgetts before, I only rode the 600 for them. And all anybody ever said to me was you're on the wrong bike because the CBR 600 is the slowest 600 that there is before they brought this new model on. It's the slowest it is. And I'm like, they are in general, but the Padgetts one never is.
Putting a Padgett stick on a motorcycle is like flame stickers when you're seven. You know what I mean? It's fast now. It's like
10 horsepower.
Easy.
Padgett sticker.
10
horsepower.
Easy.
So I don't know what he ever did to it, but he did something that everybody else couldn't figure out. And they're just, they are knowledgeable. They know what they're doing. They've done it for so many years. And even the old bike, which was, as standard, the slowest bike by far, they made on par with everything, on par with the R6s and stuff, or
easy
as quick. We always went through speed traps quick as anyone. And when they got this new bike, they were working away and they said, "This is hard work," but I knew it was going to be good, because when Clive comes to you and goes, this is better than the old one, you know, you believe it is. He's always right. He is always right. So,
because to be honest, your 600 career, it's kind of been Honda based, because with the Burroughs lads, who were 600 Honda, and then you've gone from there to Padgett's, and then from there to there to there. So you're pretty much Honda's top dog.
Wilson Craig's last year as well.
Jesus, where have the high course?
So it's always CBR 600. So I've got a good gauge with them. But
you've just realised that now, haven't you?
Yeah, I've got a good gauge.
Do you know, in contrast from riding for the official Honda team to riding for Clive's team, is the I presume it's a much more of a sort of like a family feel. Do you feel like that suits you better? And is there much of a difference in terms of how the team feels?
Yeah, it's the opposite ends of the scale, to put it bluntly. It really is, because it's super corporate, and obviously the Honda budget is much bigger and what have you, and they've got a ton of staff, whereas the Padgett team is just super relaxed, super family feel. Like, everything that goes in there, there's no I don't know the best way to put it, like, they don't have the hospitality truck, nothing fancy there. And Clive actually like almost prides himself in saying, like, the money that we have, we don't put into stuff that we don't need. So he doesn't have like fancy chef and all food getting made and all this, that and the other. It's like the money that they put in goes into the engines and the bikes being as good as they possibly can be. And
10 brake horsepower sticker.
As a rider, you can't honestly ask for any more. It's relaxed. Don't ask any, you know, social media stuff from you and stuff like that. It's literally just, if you turn up like to ride your bike and you go out and ride as good as you can ride, we can't ask any more from you. And there's no pressure there either. Like, there's no expectation. You're here to do a job. You better go out and win. He's like, the thing he always says, and he's like, your safety comes first. And that showed in the last race at the Northwest, where I actually said I'd go out because we had the tyre issues and everybody had the issues, but we were in a better state than anybody else. We were on the harder tyre. And Dunlop said, it's not, we advise everybody to not ride on Dunlop tyres.
And I said, fair play to Dunlop to make that announcement, because that's a big ballsy thing.
It's a big thing, and they had to do it, but they did. So hats off. Yeah. But I come back after the Superstock tyre blowing out, came back and said, I'll go out and race. And he was like, no, you can't, they've said that it's not safe. And I was like, I'll just go out until I feel something going wrong, like, we'll be all right, I'll have a go. And he was like, mate, your safety comes before anything else, and I don't feel like it's safe, so you're not riding. Yeah. Like, there was no choice in it.
Yeah, good.
And
I think there was only Phil and Michael Rutter that went out and done laps in the last one.
Yeah, absolutely.
On the whole grid.
Yeah, there wasn't anyone else. It was just them two. And honestly, it was the right choice. Michael's was in bad shape. I seen that after. It was in really bad shape. Yeah. And he actually ran the super stock tyre as well, not the slick.
His CPU came off, didn't they?
Dunlop's.
Are you talking about Michael on the Suzuki?
No, I'm Rutter in the last one. His was in really, like, he who actually went out in the last race.
Right.
Rutter's. Hello. And it was in pretty bad shape when he made it back, just lap time went downhill a lot towards the end, but he did get back and was obviously safe with it, but it was not in good shape. It was a bit crazy, really.
Yeah, for people who are watching this on YouTube, by the way, Dom must have had an important call, so he's just shut off. Another thing I wanted to talk about is the, obviously it was like I kind of need Dom's input on this as well, but it was very controversial. Not just the tyres, but the whole Ryan Farquhar thing and the Richard Cooper getting disqualified. Absolutely dominated the meeting. Just what you said about Glenn used to like break the pack and then just clear off. Coops was just like head and shoulders faster than everybody else. But then after winning both races convincingly, the both results were... Was he completely disqualified or was he demoted or something?
I think completely disqualified. But from my point of view, I'm gutted for him from a rider's perspective. Like,
he couldn't have done any more.
He made sure that he tried to say before the meeting at scrutineering, you know, check the bike. I don't want anything to be illegal. I want it to be proper. And obviously it's just one of those fluke things that's really weird. And yeah, just gutted for Coops, because he put the work in. He'd been out there, did the job fantastically, as everybody saw. really was head and shoulders above everyone. Like, the bike was lightning quick, but so you need someone riding it, and he was riding unreal, wasn't he? He's just absolutely done the job. And then
I've just stepped back in. What have I walked into here? The Farquhar scenario.
Yeah.
All right. Oh God, Benetton. There we go.
So first of all, the controversy started with the whole Super Twin class on the Thursday evening, because they were the last race of the day, and the race was postponed until Saturday. And at the time, I was watching on TV back home at the time, and everyone was, the people that were annoyed about it were saying there's no chance that race will run on Saturday. And to give the organisers the due, they had two but dry races in really good conditions. In a situation like that, it's obviously going to play into some people's hands and not play into other people's hands. So, for example, for Jeremy McWilliams, he would have had a decent chance of a race win or definitely a podium in the wet, where his chances of winning the dry would probably reduce a little bit, I would say. Still got like a really strong chance, I would say, like a good chance of doing well. So he was super frustrated. But in hindsight, if they'd ran that race and either somebody had got seriously hurt, or if there was a big crash or whatever, you're always going to annoy someone with your decisions, but that has, in hindsight, that did turn out to be the correct decision.
Definitely, because
they got two bone dry races in perfect conditions.
I don't think it'll really change the result anyway. Like, I have to say, Coops is an unreal wet rider as well.
So,
hands down, like, I'd have to say, if I was going to put my money on someone winning that twin race, if it ran Thursday in the wet, I would have to say Coops again.
Yeah.
I tell you what, that's a good thing about this sport, is that the fact is, because Cooper, like, fair play, he hopped on that super bike and he chased around Glenn as well. It was, Coops is never the problem. He's not the problem, like, far from it, the problem here. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Coops' ability to ride a motorcycle is far from in question here. He would have won the wet, the dry, in the middle. That's Richard Cooper all over. But I tell you what, though, I've got an opinion on the Super Twin thing, Mike, because I am a full Super Twin addict here. But I tell you what, it's.
Can I just run through like the timeline of, from like my point of view of what's happened, and then you can give us your expert opinion on like the actual
expert opinion. Wow, we are screwing up the barrel here, Mike.
So from straight after the race, the first thing I knew about it was on Facebook, and the first thing that I read was that Coops had been disqualified for something really trivial, like a fairing bracket was in the wrong place or something like that. And all of the Facebook comments and stuff were like apps. And also in that first comment, status or whatever, it blamed, or it might have been that night, it blamed Jamie Coward for protesting. So Jamie was getting loads of abuse. And then the following day or whatever, there was another status put out saying it wasn't Jamie, it was somebody in his team, and sort of asking people to not to be nasty to Jamie, but he would have still got like tons of abuse. And then it's over the last few days, it just seems to have developed from a fairing bracket into something to do with the frame, but I've got no idea about it. So what was the actual thing that bike was disqualified for?
But this is the thing, right? And it's typical, because when's the last time a bike got disqualified from the Northwest 200? Exactly. So when's the last time any bike got disqualified from Irish racing? Yeah, a lot of fucking echoes in here. It's right, though. You know what I mean? They've never actually pulled it. They've actually brought in like weight limits, and they've brought in all these ruling. And now the mad thing is, a week prior to the Northwest, we're going to actually put a brake horsepower limit to actually even up the class and make it fair racing. And even, there's such mixed emotions with that class, because you look at Lee Johnson, he pulled in, didn't he, off the race, and you know what, it's just not the same. Hickman's riding around in the 660 Aprilia, and so was Lee Johnson. He was riding his absolute heart out.
When you say that nobody gets disqualified in general, do the bikes get, is there like a proper scrutineering process?
The TT, for example, the TT will strip your bike. There is no question about it. If you're in the top three, bang, strip, 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 strip. And they'll just keep working out till which bikes legally won the race, kind of thing. But bearing in mind, they're one of his own. Ryan Farquhar pretty much almost single-handedly built the class. You know, competition has to make that to make the class grow. And he's always had a very big hand in writing the rules and everything on that side of things. Now, for the Northwest to publicly say that bike is disqualified over a fairing bracket, crock of shite. Why would
did they publicly say that?
No, but you see, this is the thing. There's that many. The bike has been disqualified. So Joe Lachlan has won the race. I tell you what, Joe Lachlan had a good ride. He is proper. Like, shout out to Joe. He did mint on the 600 and the Super Twin. But
I got to give a shout out to Pierre, my French mate. Oh, he won the first race. He can't technically now won the first race.
Yes, there you are, Pierre. He can't drink, but my God, he can ride a bike, man. He as well. He can ride a bike. Him, no, what a sound lad he is. At, what do you call it? Mette. What a laugh that was.
I've never met him, but he's brilliant on TV. He's very charismatic and like
great lad. Honestly. He's a hell of a lot of fun. Me and Dom obviously spent Meta out with him, having a few beers and that. But
I was just doing loops. No, but like you say, but the fact is, a decision has been made. Now the problem is, I wasn't standing there or anything like that. This is the problem. It's like any opinion. They're exactly like arseholes. Everyone's got one. But what they can do with this bike, and that's why they're probably stipulating on the fairing bracket issue, is the fact is they can remove a part of the frame, which gives it more flex in the turn. So now, but bearing in mind, let's go back to the main thing. Richard Cooper doesn't need the bike altering that much to win a race. You know, you would have put him on knocked a cylinder off, he would have been at the front. That's just Richard Cooper, which is never in question.
We've established that Richard, like, pretty much on a standard bike would have put, or like, any sort of decent bike would have won. Like, his, nobody's questioning his riding ability. It's just the bike.
But it's the fact is, for the Northwest to say the bike is disqualified is big news in itself. Now, why would the Northwest stick their neck out on just a fairing bracket? I'm just posing questions here. You know what I mean? And change the results, to change everything about that event, when really it would have been picture perfect to go, no problem, off you go.
So is it a fact that the bit of the frame was taken out?
This is the thing. Nothing's been stipulated.
I've not seen any official thing.
But I've seen it done in like club level and stuff like that, and it gives the frame more flex. It does allow the bike to turn more. But
does everyone know that you're not allowed to touch the frame?
In the regulations, you cannot modify the frame.
So it's like a fair, whether it's been on purpose or a mistake, it's a fair disqualification.
Either way, in their defence, like, not taking anything away from Cooch, because he deserved the victory.
Yeah.
But where do you draw the line with rules and stuff? Like, you can't just be like, well, he did break the rules, but it's all right. So what, like, you give it 900 horsepower, but he broke the rules as well. Like, where's the line of, like, you can break the rules a little bit, but not a lot. Like, whether it's a fair bracket or what.
For me,
like,
there's no question there. You've just got to have rules that people stick to. And it's black or white. Like, if you say
it's
you
really
can't
frustrating
touch
that it is, if it's something small, it's really frustrating. But then it's like,
why
over a fairing bracket go down that route? And I'd say, you see, this is the problem, because Farquhar released a statement, and I think one of the questions towards him was, are you a bit nervous about your bike? Because the 700s are relatively new, apparently, you know, so like the reliability of them. And then he openly, and this is on quote, that he said, oh no, we've been developing this bike with Derek McGee last year at Armoy. Derek McGee obliterated the lap record in a 650 race, and he's basically, Farquhar's just turned around and said, well, he was on a 700. So you're thinking, hold on. So does that mean Joe Lachlan's won now the Armoy and Adam McLean's come second? There is, there'll be Super Twin fans listening going, oh, God, Bennett. But I tell you what.
And the bike would not have been stripped at Armoy, that's for
100%, 100%. But the thing, you know that old saying, there's no such thing as bad publicity, because everyone's talking about Super Twin. So hopefully, I'm praying it gets sorted. And it's just like, for God's sake, it's just handbags at dawn sometimes, isn't it? Mm-hmm. But it's desperate times. But we're rolling on to the T. Super Twin at the TT? No. No? Gutted?
I am gutted, yeah, because I had one lined up. I don't want to talk about it.
I do. I do. Come on.
I had one, a really good one lined up. You could say a race winning one lined up.
Oh, stop being a bloody tease, will you? Just spit it out, will you?
I'm not.
Yeah. How are you?
I'm a Honda man, so
Honda
don't have a Super Twin, so
no. Are you actually contracted by Honda still? Or
yeah.
All right.
That's right. Honda are still supporting us with the BSB.
Good.
In doing a full season of BSB. Not saying Padgett's have required any help, but I think more in the little financial side of getting the job done.
Good.
Padgett's are a small team, and obviously Honda are still supporting us. I still personally get a little bit of help from Honda. So, yeah, they still have a say that...
Fair enough. Are you selling in generators for cash?
In the grand scheme of things, it's one of them things, like, you can't please everyone, but in the grand scheme of things, it's good. Now, going into the TT, we've spoke, obviously we'll have this, we'll chat every week on the podcast about, and TT comes up a lot, and we've been kind of tipping you, even before the Northwest has been, I think, since the last TT, you've like been putting the hard graft in at the short circuits and stuff, and you're kind of in a good position going to this year's TT. You're out on the 600, the Superstock, and the Superbike. I bet you're like absolutely buzzing to get back.
Yeah, absolutely peaking to get there now. Like, honestly, I was already excited, but certainly after the Northwest, and you ride around, you ride around at speed because you're always unsure. You can test bikes anywhere, but you can never test bikes for the TT or for the Northwest anywhere. You just never get the same. Like, whether you go to Derby Circuit and it's a bit bumpy or not, like, it's just not the same. So actually going to the Northwest and being at speed and your bike's stable and easy to ride, or like easy enough to ride, and you're happy to then progress on to the TT going, I'm excited to go there on bikes that I'm happy to go there on with. I'm in a good position. Like, it just makes you even more excited to get there and get going.
The one thing that everyone keeps talking about and like leading up to the TT was, oh, it's going to be totally different with that kind of gap. Do you agree? I think that's I tell you what, Northwest was coming up. No one questioned Northwest. We haven't been at the Northwest for 3 years, and everyone went around there not thinking, shit, which way is it going
to
go?
Can I just say that?
Like, come to the TT.
As my first time at the Northwest, I was like like mega impressed with like lots of aspects of it. But just driving around, I mean, the crowds were like...
You got spoiled.
You both will know. The crowds were amazing. Unreal. The weather was great. Yeah. There's like such a buzz. The amount of effort that goes up for the whole like 9 mile course of like with all the sponsorship stuff and all the grandstands and stuff, like such a good event. When you think it's obviously free to watch as well, like you can't charge entry, you think like it's almost like difficult to understand how like it works, because in terms of people aren't paying to the organizers to watch, and I was really impressed. I thought it was a fantastic event.
I think because road racing, you know, it always goes in popularity waves, you know what I mean? Like any sport, you know what I mean? Goes up and down. But the fact of like, it just shows how much people missed it, because that was class, wasn't it? It was just rammed, and you thought, road racing struggling. And I think, like you say, the Northwest needed that boost. The weather on race day, it was just class. Anything, and it was just like... And you think, like, BBC Northern Ireland need to back that. Mm-hmm. Like, Northern Ireland, not BBC Northern Ireland, not BBC Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland's tourist board, sorry.
Yes, yeah.
100%. And also, I just need to give a quick shout out. I know you both got tattooed from Chris, but I need to say...
Matches.
Massive thanks to his parents.
I said you wouldn't talk about that.
Massive thanks
to his... It was a beautiful night. What are you on about?
His parents, Brian and Kay, who put me and my friend Lundy up for the weekend. Had a proper nice stay. And as you know, the best breakfast in Northern Ireland. So yeah,
is Brian paid there. You to say that by any chance?
There you go. It's just up by another magic roundabout. So I've had a great time, and also broke my anchor virginity that gets mentioned all the time in the podcast. So it was nice to actually see. It's massive, isn't it? The anchor complex.
Yeah,
it's absolutely huge. But
I know, like, you know, Danny who ran it, he's no longer running it. Danny,
I don't know.
You don't need to know
usually, by the time you get in there, you can't really see anyway.
So. That's pretty much the crack of it. But no, I'll tell you what, let's talk TT. No, I think, did you touch on the fact that you only rode a superbike twice, instantly competitive? Is that calm you? You tell me, has it calmed you down, or did it hit your expectations leading up to the TT with the superbike? Or
It's just put me at ease. It's Good. Just put me at ease going there, because honestly, I was a little bit nervous, apprehensive about riding it, because the team was super hyped, and like, our stock is good. Like, I'm really happy with that.
202 for the speed drop.
Yeah,
jeez, like, fireblade kids. Whoa.
It's fast. And I'm really happy with it. But then the team, before I'd rode the superbike, they're peaking. They're like, the Superbike is so much faster. And I'm like,
cheers, lads.
Right? And I'm like, oh, good, good. And then in my head, I'm like, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to ride this thing. Like, it's hard hanging on to the stocker. Like, it's hard work. And they're like, oh, it's so much faster, though. So much faster. It's way better. And I'm like,
no pressure, David. No pressure. Dear.
So I was like, not dreading it, but I was like, this is going to be really hard work. Oh. And then honestly, I got on it and I was like, it's easier to ride. Like, because the power is just smoother. It's like got bottom end where the stocker doesn't have bottom end, and just everything about it was smoother, and it stops quicker, and the chassis is just a little bit better, and like everything was just a bit nicer. So it was like, oh, actually, like, this is mint. Like, I feel really comfortable on it.
This is when he turns up this weekend and go, David, you had the stock engine in that, son. Hey, we're gonna put the fire breathing one in for
Honestly,
braille.
He
for
does
you.
That every time you go out as well. And like, he goes out and I'm like, the bike's mint, 600's unreal, Superbike's unreal, and he's like, they'd be faster for the TT. I'm like,
is he actually saying that?
Yeah.
Is he actually saying
every time? Like, every time you ride one of the Paget's bikes, he'd be like, it'd be better next time.
And
he's just always right, and every time you jump on it, it's better. And like,
do you know, that is look, class. Going ahead into the TT, do you have any particular sort of things you want to tick off, or like anything? Is there anything that you think, I really want to achieve this, or you're just going to sort of go give it your best and whatever will be, you'll be? Sort of
I don't want to have any expectation. It's still just my third year.
Sorry, what was that then?
I think everybody would be lying if they said they didn't want to win. Because you obviously want to win. And like, if that happens, that would be unreal. That'd be like a dream come true. But I don't want to go there expecting, like, if you go there being like, I need to be top three, then in practice, if you're not top three, you're going to be frustrated. And then you're going to go out the next time and push. And I don't want to go out there and like push where I don't feel comfortable pushing. I just want to ride as fast as I feel comfortable riding and not do anything sketchy, because it takes some learning, the TT, and we have been away for some time. I don't think that's going to affect the lap time. I think everybody's going to go as quick as ever. If we're going to have a warm weather, I think the lap time is going to be as quick as I've ever been, if not broken. Like, it's not what everybody expects of like, oh, everybody's had years out, everybody's going to be really slow. That isn't going to happen. Like, everybody still knows where they're going. Everybody's still riding week in, week out, riding different bikes here and there. Definitely no change there, but I still have only had 2 years there, like, and it's the well-known thing, 3, 4, 5 years there until you really know the place and you feel like you can push. And I wanted to take that in, and I did that in my second year there, and it went way better than I could have ever imagined, doing 131 and a half mile an hour lap and getting a P6. I was like, I didn't ever expect that. So I was like peaking with that. And that was on a bike that I wasn't necessarily comfortable with. We had a lot of issues, had problems. We didn't have any practice laps, like, or barely any, because the weather was terrible.
Was that the Benz BMW?
Benz BMW, like, it maybe just didn't suit me, the bike, but we struggled to get it set up, and we were using different tire manufacturers at different races. So it was hard for us to get worked out properly. So then I look at this year and going into it, and I'm like, I just need to do the same thing, go into it with no expectation, just ride as fast as I feel comfortable riding and see where we end up, see what happens, because I did that before and it worked out really well. And I'm now going into it in a better position than I've ever been in before, with bikes that I'm all fully comfortable with, super happy with. I wouldn't change a clicker on them. And going into it, like, yeah, riding more than I've ever rode before, doing British Championship, and like, yeah, there's nothing that sort of doesn't say that it wouldn't be better. Mm-hmm. But in the same breath, I still don't want to expect anything. I just want to go there and see what happens.
You know, if you had a crystal ball right in front of you now, and you're sitting and say this, the British never happened for you, and you're stuck on the rhythm that got you to where you are, you know, like with the Supermoto, and you could get what you can get your hands on. Do you reckon you could have done what you did at the Northwest without the British?
I don't know. It's really hard to say.
Because the competitive man in the end, the ambition man, is saying that, but it's interesting, because like it just solidified Davey Todd, that Northwest. And the best thing is, in my opinion, you've capped yourself really early. What happens at the TT is just the TT. Like, it's the biggest event, but you've proven, absolutely nailed it down, that you're like, you know what? I made the snake kids. And it was class. But how crucial has been the British for that? In your opinion?
I think it's crucial for like coming on as a rider, but there's so many other things that I think is crucial. I've been like riding in the off season and doing tons of testing. I've always been like, I see everybody out in Spain in winter, riding before Christmas, riding after Christmas. And I'm like, I wish I was riding. I feel like I'm massively on the back foot here. I'm going to really struggle once we get back on a bike and once we get testing. And then that never happens. You get to the first test and you're just where everybody else is. And like, I was so worried, particularly this year, and even been with Padgett's and knowing the bikes are going to be good. And I was just riding tons of motocross and just flat out went to Spain and just rode motocross every day and just felt like was loving my motocross and not thinking about it, but still out there, rode a little bit with Tom Ward and Ryan Vickers and Brad Ray. And they all had bikes with them, like 1,000cc stockers or whatever they're allowed to ride by the rules. And they had them on, so I'd ride with them one day, and then the next day they'd go off to Superbike track and be spinning laps and stuff like that. And I'm like, I'm missing out here. And like, I know there's no point me messaging Clive going, can we go testing in Spain? Because it'll be a no, they're too busy, they're doing what they're doing and it'll be fine. So I did get a little bit worried, but yeah, just then turned up at the first test and we were just like, it wasn't like I was massively on a back foot or anything. I think you all know how to ride a bike, you don't forget. Like, you get back on and a session or two, it clicks back in and you're just back to where you were.
Because we were, funny enough, like thinking that through the winter as well, where the only ones not in Spain, us three were the only people not in Spain. Well, sorry, you were there on a motocross. It's like you were in Spain on the wrong track.
Do you know, 131.5 mile an hour on the TT, where does that put you in all time?
I don't know. It's about eighth or something.
So top 10 all time.
Yeah, I think it's top 10.
Do you know, Dom's just made the Hall of Fame for Northwest.
don't say that in front of him.
So do you know, top 20 fastest ever laps around the Northwest. Dom's just made it in the top 20 at this year, so 20th.
What did you do? What lap time?
4:28.
4:27,
did you?
Yeah, fucking don't knock me a second.
Well, the lap record before this week was a 4:22.
22. I've only ridden that bike at Cadwell before going there. Like in love with it.
Did you do it on the stocker or the?
Yeah, stocker. Yeah. Hold on, I'm trying to find. I'm going to find your time.
That's
going to be
again.
Considerably higher than mine.
Yeah, he's second.
I did a 20 on the stocker.
Oh no.
4:20 on the stocker.
You're the fourth quickest ever around, at a 4:19.33.
Quickest.
Who's the three ahead?
Sorry, mate.
Oh, disgusting.
Hold on, kids. Like, for the YouTube viewers, this is two lap record breaking Davey Todd. There you are.
Who's top three? So Hickman, Glenn,
and Cooper.
Yeah, Glenn and Cooper went quicker in that last race.
Yeah.
To be fair, you couldn't have, mate.
I'm all the way down in 20th, but I'm still on the list, Jorgen. I'm still on the list. There you are.
To be honest, I had that same list before the race, and I was like looking at him. And
yeah,
I was,
you
like,
fine well
because I was in like just in the top 20, I think, before the event from like 2019. I had like I think it was like a 27 or 28 or something like that,
right?
From last time, but yeah, it was like.
Well, the last time I was there, I was looking back. I was doing 4:42, 4:43.
It's mad. They're like,
that's quite a jump in there.
From someone from like short circuit racing, you're like, what? The gaps are huge. It's mad, but
big
nine mile lap, like it's long, isn't it?
It is. Little gains.
We've got quite a few Patreon questions. I seen a thing on, just before we get on to this, I seen a thing on Instagram. Are you setting up some, is it like a chat show thing or like a...
Not a podcast, are you? Because we could delete this as quick as we can.
No, it wasn't mine. It wasn't anything to do with me. It's there's something else going on. But
you can plug it. You know, you're talking about.
No, they've canned it. It's all right. Yeah.
Oh, wait.
I don't know. They were expecting a lot more people to sign up to it, and they didn't. So
not yet. Not yet. Give it time.
Dean and John and Dave or something. We're doing like a pre-TT talk, but they're maybe going to do it later or not all. I don't know.
Fair enough.
By the way, I must apologise to the listeners because there'll be people. You get no commission here, son. We don't get any ourselves. But no, I must apologise. It's me that's having to run away from this interview. There'll be people screaming down at their things, going, "Why are you trying to tidy this up?" But it's like you lads can still sit and chat. I've got to go get my eye socket realigned at Aidan Robinson's there at ITRM, so he keeps pushing it back. Oh, it's a right break. You seen it?
I have seen it. Yeah.
It looks like, I look like bloody like I'm like Dracula. I've got to hide in the dark all the time. You know what I mean? But no, I must apologise to all our listeners that I'm cutting this one a little bit short. But Davey, you're not going anywhere. You're going to win the senior, and we're definitely having you back there. There you go. Won't be able to afford you there. But anyway, here, Patreon questions. There you are. Yeah. Apologise to the Patrons before the question.
Quick one. So Andy Hosking said, "What do you prefer, short racing, short circuit racing, or road racing, and why? What is your most embarrassing moment, either in sport or personal life, and does it beat Pissy Rouse, aka the Yellow Ninja?" That was just from a few weeks ago. I have to retell this story on like every podcast now. Just when I was done, I pissed myself at a karate lesson. So it's like, do you have a most embarrassing moment of your life?
You know what I mean?
I don't know. It's pretty tough, isn't it? Like, I do a lot of embarrassing.
He lives near Middlesbrough, you know, it's gonna happen, isn't it? But I tell you what, I hope one day there'll be a load of pit like Chrissy Rouse fans in like karate suits,
yeah,
like,
suits.
Like, on the side of like one of the corners. I'm like, ah! I hope someone listens to this and gets a group page going or something. But no, come on, you just must have loads.
No, when
he draws on people's faces when he's pissed. When that's I used to an work, irritable thing he does. He just gets a Sharpie and
that
sad.
Wasn't me. That was John.
Was it John that time?
When I used to work at Nando's, I was once lining up on the, I was on the front row of the grid at Knock Hill. And you know, the crowd are here. I looked to the right, one of my mates, Dick, he'd had a replica helmet of mine made and dressed up as a life size chicken because of the man. So I can just envisage this year he's going to be in a karate suit with a big yellow fist. But it's an embarrassing story that stands out.
I crashed once coming out of pit lane. I had like a massive high side because I was getting pressured to like get out first and qualify when I race supermoto. And it was like, get out quick. And then I tried to get out first and quick and then high side in front of everybody, like literally still on the exit.
Is this cab? So,
no, it was on a supermoto track, a T-side autodrome, actually. And hurt myself as well. It's like smashed all my elbow in.
Shut up.
That was really embarrassing, yeah, because everybody is literally still stood there in pit lane like, what did you
and
just do?
The short circuit road racing, I presume you prefer the road racing book.
Yeah, once Dom will agree, like once you do the TT, nothing compares. So like you do the TT and then everything else is good. And yeah, I love everything else. I love every kind of bike racing, motocross, supermoto, like everything. I love doing it all, but nothing is quite the TT.
If you were going to give up the TT for anything.
Nothing, no.
Not even being a front runner in like supercross or...
Oh,
here we go. Ooh. Scratching the itch.
You got me there.
MotoGP, a front runner on a car, like, you know, a Honda. Sorry, Honda. Got to say Honda, but like, you know, world level MotoGP. I'm talking
as opposed to the TT.
No. Yeah, you had to give up. Like, no. Not even for the rest. Like, you do the TT. This you've done the TT. You've almost done it. But there's so much more that you can achieve and you will achieve. But. You thought, right, Davey, let's
why
just
are you even
take
asking
out...
me the question? Because you've rode around the TT course. Right. You know that feeling that you get riding around there.
I know.
Nothing is the same as that. I don't care. I'd love to ride a MotoGP bike, but it can't be the same as that.
I would love, if because I've done it. That's the thing, because we've done it.
As a career supercross rider. Maybe.
Yeah, come on. If I could rewind the clock back, imagine pulling up next to David Villam and McGrath, and I would love to, because motocross is the hardest sport in the face of the earth, and being at the front of that elite class in supercross, it'll be just and Monster Energy girls are fit as well, so they're just bombing around the place, it'd be awesome.
It's so hard because that was that, like, for all my life, and everybody's always asked you the question, must have always been dreamed of being a MotoGP rider, superbike rider, TT racer, whatever. And it was like, you know what, until like 5 years ago, maybe six,
yeah, when you started.
Like, I wanted to be a motocross rider. Like, since being born to then, it was just motocross, supercross. Like, that was...
It's the same with Johnny Ray. I remember reading an article years ago, Johnny Ray says, I'm a failed motocross rider. And you think, he's how many times world champion? Like,
the only thing that made me cross over was getting injured, you know?
Yeah,
and
they told
me they're going to have to chop my leg off or something if I start breaking it again. So I was like, I've got to do something easier. Easier on my ankle.
Yeah, there
less,
we are.
Less abusive on my ankle because... They were talking about fusing it at like 16 years old. So
Jesus.
At that point, you're like, maybe.
He's putting the Alpine Star boots to test. There we go. I tell you what, sorry, before the next Patreon question, I'm really looking forward to seeing you back on a stock at the Isle of Man, because I think last year with the crappy weather, and everything. I think your fastest speed on the Stocker that year was a 127. But the year prior was your personal best, and your newcomer year at a 128.7 or something like that. It was so, so fast. But last year with the weather, was that on the Penn's bike as well? No, no. Stocker.
Yeah.
Was on the Penn's bike. On the... So it just showed how many different...
It was basically a Stocker on the Superbike and the Stocker. The Superbike had a, like...
swinging arm and...
No, a slightly modded engine. Like, not full Superbike. Yeah. It was like the... What is it? The 6.2 or whatever that's like the hybrid.
Aye. But just showed, like, you know, what, because the weather conditions were crap and it weren't getting a lot of track time. But, if, like, from a 27 in that particular race to a 31 is just class. So getting on a bike that's going to be like an old glove to you, it's exciting times, like exciting times.
So I've got Jesse Moore.
What number are you? So, sorry.
8.
Shit. Right, that's good. Eight. Yeah, yeah. If you see me, it's over, pull over. I'm telling you, I'm 16.
You're 16. Who's... That's a good number. I went off 18 last year. Who's last, the last time?
Two shit, people in front of you.
Gaz Johnson, 7. Dunlop's, 6.
Right.
So.
Get the hook out, young'un.
Yeah.
If you catch Dunlop, then you're doing
that. Catch Dunlop. Just breeze over Gaz Johnson. Yeah. You just was that slide dig?
No.
He was struggling at the Northwest. I hope I catch him.
No, but like you say, Gaz. I think
you beat Gaz at the last TT, didn't you?
I did, yeah.
Yeah, I'd expect. Dig or anything, but 100%. I expect to catch him and pass him.
Yeah, that's. I actually wanted to go off 7. I would have liked to go off 7. And they did ask, and I was like, I'd like to go off 7, but just because my number 74 and 7 would be cool.
Yeah, close as near as damn it.
I mean, obviously it's a goal to catch them guys, and I know fine well if you're catching Dunlop on the road, you're going to be somewhere near. So,
who's in front of Dunlop?
5, Hillier, probably.
I reckon you'll catch Hillier.
Is Rutter somewhere up there as well?
Rutter's 3.
Oh, that's got to be good, isn't it?
John 1st. Dean 2nd. Rutter 3rd. Maybe.
Dean.
4th, Hutchie.
Out of all of them, I think...
You'll pass Hutchie.
Out of all of them, I think Dean's going to be the hardest to catch.
See,
on the road.
I'm not meaning to take this anything away from Dean, but Dean didn't pull up any pavements at the Northwest this year, but is he, because he's thinking ahead for the TT, and you know what I mean, he did an awesome job, but I was kind of expecting that bit more aggression, shall I say, but he's using his head for the TT, isn't he? So it's a different Dean we're looking at in a positive light, though.
It's a 7 o'clock, by the way. If you do,
we've got 10 minutes. I'll make it up on the motorway. I'm going to run from here. I should be in the van driving, but it's only diesel. It's only a Fortune, and this is too good. So let's keep going.
Aiden is going to be brutal with you.
Mate. I'm literally going off roading in that thing. Shortcut up the ground. Keep going.
Jess Mortimer, congratulations on a brilliant Northwest 200 week, Davey. With that in mind, has it shifted your aims at the TT? Is Connor Cummins helpful as a teammate, or has he already stopped that as you're fast enough already?
Give him loads of pizzas.
Yeah.
It's not shifted my aim, like, because I'm just trying to have the same mindset. If anything, I am more comfortable going into the TT knowing that I'm comfortable with the bikes and at speed and everything, the stable, which is the biggest thing at the TT.
Yeah.
Not riding a bike that's trying to throw you off when you're doing 200 mile an hour is nice. Mm-hmm.
Do you want a drink, by the way?
Get one down, yeah.
No, I'm all right. I want sleep.
You're all on your water.
On the water, big water there. I'm still trying to recover from the anchor.
I don't want to touch. I'm going to touch wood when I say this. But are you not nervous about this weekend? Like leading, you know, the tight timetable from doing Donington straight to the TD. But you're not the only one doing that. You know what I mean? It's like, is Dean racing this weekend on Superbikes?
No.
I don't think so.
Because Hickman's racing.
Connor's riding.
Connor's racing. With you racing. Lee Johnson will be racing. He's doing full break.
I presume your mindset here is just like, you just want to stay out of trouble, get a decent result, and then just focus on get the TT.
So it's been a little difficult so far in like British Championship, because I feel strong and like back to where I feel like I should be in the short circuits and performing better, like proving a point that I deserve to be here, like, and not just a road racer. I want to be a short circuit racer as well.
Yeah.
But in the same breath, like, every race so far, you're like, I just don't want to do anything stupid. Like, because at the end of the day, like, my bread and butter is the TT and the roads. So, like, 3 years out, I don't want to miss it again. Like, I am absolutely gutted for Davo.
Yeah.
Like having that incident at Alton Park and going down, and now he's out and he's missing the TT. I honestly am gutted for him, because you'll know the same. Like, we've looked forward to this for 3 years to then go get that close and then be like, right, now you're going to miss it for another year.
Yeah.
It's tough. So like, I don't want that situation, and like, touch wood.
Yep. Touch wood. Yep. Yep.
Like, you know what I mean? I've just stayed out of trouble, and it's been, it sort of wrecked my race a little bit so far. Silverstone for sure. I was just not first lap, not aggressive when we had the pace, not aggressive, and then fastest lap of the race. But you're never going to get through. You've rode in Superstock like enough to know you've got to be there at the start. It's not easy to come through that field and do it safely as well, like, and stay out of trouble, not end up going down, and just having a little niggly injury at this stage is like game over. Like, there's no time. So just a safe weekend, not doing anything silly, but at the same time, like, I want to win a championship, so I need to be there enough.
Yeah.
I know exactly what you mean. Okay. It's a hard one to balance, but
would you sacrifice one TT to win a stock championship?
No.
So I'm just thinking, imagine if you just pissed off into the distance on the first couple of rounds in stock 1000.
You wouldn't.
A little light at the end of the tunnel, and you just thought, I can afford to have 1 year out. Let's go get a championship. Would you do it? Just no.
No. No, the TT is too much for me now, like, in terms of like, my career and moving forward in my career. The TT is what is making it. Like, if it wasn't for that, you know, I would be, as you boys know, like, paying an absolute fortune to be here, like, to get on the Superstock grid, like, because, like, that's the thing now. Everybody's paying so much money to be with a team, and having to raise so much money to even get there. It's just not possible. So it's the roads that has given me the opportunity to be here. So
in Rutter's book, he's, and he got that from his dad. So he's, have you read Michael Rutter's book?
No.
He's on doing a second. He's on doing a second one at the moment. But in his book, he said his dad said to him at a young age, if you do the roads, you'll always have a seat, and you'll always have a good ride. And so he's always had like good rides, good sponsors and stuff from that.
Which is sort of the case.
Oh, like, definitely.
The newcomers list for Paul Phillips is going to be strong next year.
At the end of the day, you're elevating yourself from, say, if you weren't doing the TT, you'd be like a very good national rider to one of the best international road races in the world. So it's like, it is a huge step up in terms of, and like, in terms of popularity, in terms of sponsorship opportunities, you know, like the massive international events with huge media coverage.
It's just
huge. And you deserve, and at the end of the day, you're all massively deserve that credit. You deserve a lot more in real terms, but unfortunately our sport just hasn't got the following that I think it deserves.
Hasn't got the cheddar.
But yeah, for like, for the spectacle that you're putting on and the performances and stuff, like, the, yeah, really, like, if in a fair world, it would be rewarded a lot more than it is, but we're all happy doing it.
But we're all happy.
But we would like some more money.
Cigarettes. Bring back cigarettes. That's what I say. You know what I mean?
John Hamilton, what part of your riding do you consider your strength or easiest? Conversely, what area do you have to work on most? Who would you prefer to marry, your sister, Dom or Chrissy? Have you got a sister?
No.
No, he's not going to say that. He's not going to say that now, is he? You know what I mean?
Absolutely not.
See, okay, who's going to marry your sister?
If you had a sister.
Really fit sister. Like, she went to church on Sundays. You know what I mean? Fit, though. We're talking. You know when you bite your
lip? She's a church girl, and maybe Chrissy.
There you are. No,
I think you'd be the most favourite one.
Yeah, damn right. Yeah. I'm talking bite your bottom lip fit. You know, you're like that. There's that Todd. There's Toddy.
If had a sister, she wouldn't be at the racetrack.
There's Totty Toddy. There you are. There's Totty Toddy walking.
I think one thing that's like an obvious question that I've never asked that question to someone, but do you feel like you've got a particular strength or a particular something you're working on, or?
I don't know. Strength for me has always been on braking. I've always been strong on the brakes. I don't really know why. It just just works well.
Just fucking mega.
Weakness.
Just gifted.
Weakness qualifier.
Are you looking through a soul there, Chris? He's like, I'm fucking mega at braking. You don't do much.
Fair class. Yeah. Absolutely. There's no points for qualifying, though, is there? But it helps you get more points in the race. So
it helps so much. Yeah. And it's something that I am trying to work on. It is like putting a lap together in qualifying.
You don't massively need that for roads, though, really, do you? It's more of a shorter.
Certainly not. Yeah. And not for the TT at all. Yeah. So that's fine. I'll be sat in P8 no matter what. So.
Philip Hannon, congratulations on all your podiums at the Northwest 200. On a scale of 1 to 10, how wet was the circuit when racing on Thursday night? Also, would you agree that your Honda Supersport bike is as competitive as an R6? Looked like a rocket. All the best for the season. The wet race on the Thursday, I presume if it was, it couldn't have got much more wet before, it would have to be cancelled. It was like borderline.
I mean,
with racing,
couldn't have
racing wet at roads.
Have you?
Oh God, I
have. Like, it looked terrifying watching it.
Wet.
Yeah, standing water.
Wetter than a horse's pocket.
Saying that, I came from Tamragia the week before, and that was soaking. Yeah. I had loads of grip though.
I don't know. Not like the organisers always make the best decision, and they obviously did because they got two dry races. But
and it was like that's Tenerife.
Tenerife. That one. Well, I wouldn't mind right now, but it's warm enough here.
Yeah, it is.
Personally, I said at the time, like, there's no reason why they shouldn't run the twin race at the time.
Yeah.
Because we'd just been out on 600s, which are more powerful, and then on Superstock bikes, which are way more powerful, and we'd managed that fine. So then why not on the arguably safest bikes going out there? Why didn't they run?
And like we said, even removing what you thought at the time, it did turn out to be the correct
decision. It did turn out to be the right decision.
The thing is, what's upsetting is the fact that you're getting dragged out of the grid and you're holding on. We all know why it's happened, but it's a shame they can't just tell us that in the briefing. It's telly time. BBC, they've got a slot time to fit it in and they have to fulfil it. That's what these riders' briefings are about. It's a bit like, look, lads, in order to keep the sport going, this is what may happen. Can we put on a show? Instead of just, to be blunt, it's that little bit of lack of communication to go, look, this is why we're doing it, instead of taking the piss and everyone just going, well, making assumptions and going down it. It's like, look, this is X, this is Y.
Get over it.
You know what I mean, though?
Yeah, anything, it makes sense. And it's something they should
really highlight. You know, right. Going, look, we have to do this in order, because this we all want the sport to keep going.
This is why the event's on, because we're getting money for this. It needs to still be a bit of a show. So
an open book instead of
on the 600 point. So like before the Northwest, I would have massively tipped Lee Johnson for the TT, and I still think he's got a very strong chance of taking the Supersport TT. But a lot of that reasoning for me was I thought the Yamaha was like by far the best bike. After the Northwest, I thought you looked I felt like you looked really strong on the straight. And my opinion of, in my head, I thought the Yamahas were like up here and everything else was down here. I've readjusted my opinion. Like I think you've got like a fair chance on the Supersport thing. I presume you feel like they're quite evenly matched.
Yeah, I don't want to have say that I'm going to be competitive at the TT or whatever.
Yeah, but you are.
No competitive and no expectation thing.
Yeah.
But in terms of like my Honda against the Yamaha, they've both got strengths and weaknesses, but I would reasonably evenly match. And certainly mine wouldn't be bad for TT because the strengths and weaknesses basically, and everybody was quick to go, it's your bike's by far the quickest. Against Lee Johnson, but it top speed it was, and that's why I was always quicker. But you watch out of every corner, and the Yamaha goes
what?
Like just gets us a few bike lengths out of the corner, and then I could come back at the end of the straight.
The Isle of Man's 264 corners.
Well, you don't really slow down too much, though.
Stop starting
at they're out there like second gear, first gear little chicanes at the Northwest, even though over Black Hill as well, it seemed to do that same thing. But you don't know. You sort of can keep the RPM up there on that Honda, and once it's going, it's good.
I tell you what though, it's just nice to have another bike in the mix, and that is the biggest crucial side of it. I think like having that bike there is massive. But I tell you what, who really put a smile on my face, and obviously you're going to be competitive, Lee's going to be competitive, but Michael didn't half string some laps in together. You know what I mean? He didn't, you know, and that you and Lee were just tussling it out and just sussing each other out. And Michael just went, it was like, just like baby shark, like, dee, 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 dee. And it was like, here yeah. And I thought, oh, what did he say? I think he just ran on. He made a silly little mistake. He openly admitted to that.
There was shitloads of people running on at university, wasn't there? Like, in all the races. I don't know if I've heard different things to do with like engine braking and whatever, but it just seemed, watching from the side, like nearly every race, people were running on there.
It's just a simple misjudgment thing. As much as everybody wants to go, oh, it's like engine brake, it's this, that, the other. Like, you're just trying to brake as late as you possibly can, and sometimes you might go slightly past that, or you might get a bit of a slipstream, and then don't take into account you may be going a few mile an hour quicker, and then you try and take a couple of feet out your braking marker, and then you're like, oh, and you're not going to make the corner. That's it. Like, at that speed, like, 600 is 108 mile an hour. So, like, the big bike's 200 mile an hour. It's like...
Without that tyre delamination in the Superstock race, you would have definitely won that race, considering you ran straight on, jumped across the grass, jumped the ditch, went back to about 6th or 7th, and then you were, like, 4 seconds a lap faster than everyone else. And without the tyre going, like, you would have definitely cut... Was it Seeley that won that one, wasn't it?
Yeah, Seeley won it, and obviously we'll come in. But at the start of that, like at the start of the weekend, I was like, if there's a race that's going to be mine, it should be that one. Because arguably the 600 race is Lee Johnson's. He races British Championship, races this Super Sport bike week in, week out. So if somebody's going to win that, it should be Lee. If somebody wins a super bike race, it should be Glenn. He rides that bike week in, week out. Glenn or Hickey or someone who rides a super bike week in, week out. I ride the Superstock bike week in, week out at British Championship. Like,
your class
should have a good chance of being a little bit more comfortable on that bike than the other ones. I was happy with the other ones, but that certainly, you know, when you've rode other bikes, like that you ride the most, you feel just a bit more comfortable on that one. There's barely any difference between that and my super bike, but for some weird reason, you're just like, fit into it that little bit better, and you just feel at one with that a little bit more.
And they're still trying to adjust to their stocker when you're hopping on This Is Home. There we are. I tell you what, lads, I'm really sorry. You can slag me off all you want when I leave this door, because I know it's going to happen, 100%, rightly so. But David here, thank you so much for being on the show. We'll see you on the rock. Good luck for this weekend. Good luck for this weekend. Oh, shit, the bed, mate. Mike's just wrecking the show. There you are. And Mint, absolutely Mint. Thank you, patrons. Thank you, Colchester. Peace out. Loved you all. Bye. Go.
I was just going to say, Dom, next time I see you, I'll see you at, it'll be over the TT. So have a safe trip over there.
Awesome. Bag of goodies. Mint.
And I think that's it. Yeah, I've only got a few more.
I haven't even got my shoes. I'll literally hand my shoes over. This is class. This is not smooth, this operation, at all. Cheers, man.
I don't know what night it is, but you know the Bennett's barbecue thing. I'll see you there.
We'll see you there, David. David's a sucker for a free meal.
Oh, yes. Barbecue. As long as you've got vegan burgers on the go.
There you go.
Are you vegan now? How long have you been vegan?
Vegan for 3 years.
Yeah. And was that after watching Game Changers?
Not actually.
See you, mate.
See you, man.
See you, mate.
So I had a crash at the Ulster Grand Prix. I don't know, like, you remember 2018, I crashed at Deer's Leap at like 160, 170 mile an hour. And was lucky to get away with it. But after that, for some reason, like I've been told, severe trauma can create intolerances in your body. And it, he's back already.
I know, I'm back. Sorry, you vegans and all sorts. ask him about that rash, Chrissy.
After that crash, severe trauma can create intolerances, and I ended up being intolerant to gluten and dairy. Gluten, dairy, eggs. I don't know if eggs come under dairy. Milk, eggs, and anything with wheat in it. So
from that crash.
So ever since then, I'm like halfway to being vegan anyway, with missing out the milk and eggs. So it was like, after that, we read a few things, and my trainer actually told me about it, and he was like, you need to try this. Like, there's so many people doing it now, so many different athletes trying going plant-based. You want to give it a go? And I'm like, it can't work. It can't possibly, you know, surely missing out on some nutrients or whatever. And I was like, you know what? I'll give it a go. If you want me to try it, I'll try it. And literally tried it for a couple of weeks and honestly felt a change straight away. Just stopped eating meat and I did feel better straight away, and I was like, it must be because I've just been training. I've been training really hard, and it's probably because of that, and it's just one of those things that's in your head.
Mm-hmm.
So then for 2 days or one or two days, I ate meat. Again, not a lot, not a smash loads of full English. I mean, it just had a bit of chicken or whatever, and immediately felt lethargic and tired and didn't recover from my day training as well.
Mm-hmm.
So that pretty much sold it for me. And then ever since then, I'm just I'm not bothered anymore. I don't miss it.
A few riders are vegan. Jake Dixon's, I don't know if he still is, but I think he is as well. Is there anything in particular that you miss?
No, so to be honest, I do have I'll have meat now and again, but now and again, maybe a couple of times a year, just be like if everybody's gone a Christmas night out, which I actually did a Christmas night out with a few friends, and everybody went to a steak restaurant. I didn't want to be that awkward person, and I was like, I'll have a steak. But if it wasn't for that, I don't miss it. I don't crave anything. It's not bad, but then I do feel lethargic, a bit tired, a bit bloated the next day. So I'm like, yeah, it sort of sells it for me that I'd rather not feel a bit rubbish, you know? I don't miss it. And there's plenty of options these days. There's so many plant-based options, vegan options for food and everything. It's becoming so much more popular in restaurants and supermarkets and everything. So there's tons to choose from, and don't miss it.
And you train with Sam Yassin, don't you?
Mm-hmm.
I guess you put a lot of effort and stuff with that in. Is that mainly just sort of cycling and gym stuff? And
yeah, do a lot of strength and conditioning with Sam, obviously, and then aside from that, tons of cycling build into my training schedule. To be honest, I enjoy my cycling anyway, and then certainly off season a lot more because it's hard to have the time now the season started. But motocross, I think riding a bike is still one of the best things that you can possibly do
during the season as well.
I still ride motocross during the season. Just it's hard to fit it in. Honestly, I just I probably not rode in a few weeks now, certainly before the Northwest and maybe before Alton even. But I still try and ride as much as I can. I just try and again not do anything silly, not get carried away with myself, trying to race people around the practice track. So just
it's all mitigating risk, and it's the same as this weekend. It's just our life in general, isn't it? You kind of want to, if you did nothing, no dangerous training, you would be on the back foot. So you've kind of, and it's so easy when there is, now and again, people are going to make mistakes, and whether it's your fault or unforced error, now and again, there is going to be cock-ups, and it's so easy for people to jump and say, well, you shouldn't, and have opinions. But if you did the other choice of doing nothing, you would be uncompetitive. So you've kind of, absolutely. And it's to each person's things. It's so weird. This we've done the podcast for 157. This is the first time we've ever been domless. So
no way.
So we've got, we've nearly finished the Patreon questions, to be fair. Second last one. Paul Bennett, well done again for the Northwest 200. And do you have a nickname other than the Todd?
Not really. I get DT a lot. I used to get Toddy, but not really anymore.
Are you still based up in Middlesbrough?
Yeah, still in the northeast. So yeah. Can't leave the northeast, can you?
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I've been working down in Coventry,
right.
So the last few weeks I've been living down there, and I've still got loads to do. So in between the race, and I'm spending most of my time down there. But there's no feeling like I'm getting back home, is there?
Yeah.
Is it still looking like Scarborough's going ahead this year, and will you be doing it?
I think it looks like it's going ahead. It sounds positive. I was speaking to the guys not too long ago. We did a bit of a chat show for Oliver's Mount, and it sounds promising. It sounds really promising. It's a frustrating scenario where they're trying to get them buildings knocked down. They only need to knock them down. They don't need to build new ones. They just need to get them knocked down. But it's one of those weird things with the wildlife conservationists.
Yeah, something to do with bats.
There's bats in the building, so they can't just knock them down. It sounds promising. They've said it's very likely that the Gold Cup will go ahead in September.
Yeah.
And maybe around, maybe one before that, all being well, but very likely. They don't want to confirm and say 100%, but we can keep fingers crossed. And I'll keep my fingers crossed too, because I don't know whether I'll be there. I have planted the seed with Clive and tried to say, look, if it goes ahead, can we go? And he's like, oh, well, don't know, we'll see. So I would race every weekend, every race, if possible. I'd do all the Irish National Road races, race a full British Super Motor Championship, the full Motocross Championship, but they don't race every day of the week. And yeah, I would do that if I could. I would just race every day, but
it is difficult, like we were saying about mitigating risk, though. It is a difficult one with, like, I know some road racers would say they're willing to do like the big internationals, but they just feel like if they're doing all the nationals as well, it's kind of, do you know, those like sort of unforced errors that if you just keep rolling the dice, eventually something's going to go wrong. They kind of the sort of see it worth it for the big internationals, but it's not really worth it for them to do the nationals. Where I know everyone's got different opinions on stuff like that. I think you would be exactly the same as Dom, where you just like love it so much that you're happy to, you know the risks, but you're sort of happy to take it. But yeah, it's one of them where it's you've got, same with the motocross thing, you've got like a careful balance in it.
Yeah, absolutely. You got to remember it's a road race at the end of the day. And if you do that, you can only control what you can control, and that's your own riding. So you got to ride within yourself. But personally, I'd still do it. Like, I think it's still worthwhile. Obviously, in terms of like thinking about my career, I feel like the British Championship is more worthwhile. And I'm trying to prove a point with the short circuit thing and get back into being a short circuit rider as well. But I really do love them Irish National races. That they are awesome and really fun events to ride. Like, I've never not enjoyed one. Super fun. And also even the international ones, the IRRC Championship that I did in 2019, they're awesome too. And I love them. Like, they're all good, and I know there's risk with them, but like if we happen to have like 300 weekends of the year and they're all like on different weekends, I would try to do them all.
So is it IRRC? Is that mainly is it sort of all around like Eastern Europe?
Yeah, just all over Europe. So there's I'm trying to think. So there's Germany, Czech Republic, Holland, Belgium, Finland, there is one. Imatra, they're like famous GP circuit that you used to race in GPs back in the day. That was cool to race there. I think
that's all. Is it pretty well followed? Like, it's decent crowds and
see
stuff.
Like, it always amazes me because it's just not a big thing over here, but within Europe it's massive. Like, you always get huge crowds, and some of them, like, wow. Horwich in Czech Republic, I don't think I've ever seen, it was like probably the amount of spectators there were at the Northwest, there was probably at Horwich, and they invade the track on the cool down lap, and it is insane. They're getting you to down pints and stuff on your cool down lap. By the time you get to the podium, you're half row off. Like, it's insane, but like also a really well run event, like maybe apart from that bit. Mm-hmm. But I mean, it's good. But they were so fun to attend, really well run, the tracks were good, like, yeah, like they're super popular over there, and I think they're great. Like, I'd have another year at that if I could do that as well and do the Irish and do BSB and mm-hmm. everything. But
yeah, class. We've got one more Patreon question, but just a quick one from me. Obviously, Glenn's going to be making his debut at the TT this year. Lots of talk, as we've said, like, he's in the perfect sort of situation going. He like knows the bikes really well, solid team, great teammates. He's massively doing his homework. What sort of, where are you sort of expecting Glenn to fit into the, say, like the senior?
I honestly don't know. He will be good. Like, I just don't want Glenn to have go in there with any expectation, because then that he'll put the pressure on himself and then push, and you don't want to push there when you've only it's your first time there. Like,
yeah,
certainly, like, I wouldn't have liked to think that I pushed when I went there for either my first 2 years, like, because you know, there's so much risk and there's so much track to learn. It's just like nothing else that you've ever experienced before.
Do you feel, no, with your 131.5, were you not, do you feel not, like you did that like well?
Not pushing at all. Like, it was never near the edge of the track. Like, yeah. I was so within my comfort zone. The most sort of like common thing I've always said, like my team boss, John Burroughs, said to me when I first went there for my newcomer year, he said, treat it like a Sunday ride, even the races, treat it like a Sunday ride. And I remember that, and I try to do that every time. And like, yeah, obviously you're going fast, but not taking any risks, like anywhere, just going in, like trying to go in like that bit too quick and like push the front end. So everywhere you feel in your limits, well within your limits. And yeah, it was crazy. It was crazy for me, like seeing that sort of lap time from riding like that.
But that's kind of what you want, isn't it? Just like,
sort of. Yeah, which was perfect, which was good, because I'm like not far away and I'm not like pushing to that extent. But you also know what it's like around a short circuit riding yourself. Like, you can ride round a couple of seconds off and be like, feel like you could ride around with one hand, like a couple of seconds off, like super cautiously and super easy. And you're only like a bit away. It only takes that to get that last bit, is that bit that pushes. Like, you don't gain like massive amounts by pushing. It's only that last little bit. So I don't know if it's like that, but as I say, everything's sort of teed up to, I'm in a better position than I've ever been. So if I just do the same thing, I should just go better than I did last time, which will be somewhere near-ish, mm-hmm. like top five, because yep. I was P6 last time.
So. And also, it's a long career for especially road racing, like the likes of McGuinness and Rutter. Are they 50 this year or 51?
50. They're just turned 50.
You know, it's not like, say, professional football where you've like, you finished at like 34 or 35, you know, yeah. there's the opportunity for, so there's really no, it's not like you've got to do something like this year, like you say, just that sort of gradual progression's like perfect, really. And speaking of McGuinness, obviously, as we've grown up, are you 27, 26?
26, yeah.
26, yeah, same as me. So as we've grown up, like, McGuinness has been like an absolute legend and is still a legend. And it's I guess it's really cool the fact he's kind of taken you under his wing a little bit over the last few years. And like, there's pretty much nobody better in the whole world, really, for what you're aiming to do. Has he been like a massive help in sort of getting you to where you are now?
He's been a massive help in like every aspect, not just the simple ones that you would think of like learning the course and stuff like that. If anything,
nights out.
Do tons of all that stuff. Like, honestly, just in things that you wouldn't expect. Then like in doing the right thing, making the right decisions in my career and always doing things right and going, look, you don't need to do that right now. You've got a long career. Don't do anything daft. Like, he's been great in so many areas, and like the more time I spend around him too, the more time I'm like, I want to be like he is, like, because he just does everything right, and he's so good at in every aspect of what he does, how he is with fans, how he is with all the people, with the teams, with everything, every aspect. He is like you said, the perfect mentor, the perfect person to look up to and be like, you know, if I end up half as good as what he's done in his career, it'd be like, I'd be over the moon, you know what I mean? So
it'd be, obviously this is a possibility, but imagine like a podium this year with you both on, it would be like, do you know early in John's career when he got a chance, well, I think many times, but I've definitely seen a picture of him and Joey.
Him and Joey,
and it would be like almost that in like today's Joey, if you like.
Yeah, it is sort of that situation in a really similar, so that would be so cool. Like, I would love for something like that to happen. And you know what, it's like,
John's looking good
in John's sense, that's not off the cards. Like, I don't know for me, but like for John, honestly, like, it's fully possible. Like, a lot of people are quick to write him off, but I see him behind the scenes and stuff like that, and he's not done, you know. He's not is not what people are expecting. And, you know, I see him riding a motocross bike and enduro bike and pit bikes even around the house. And he's like around, like outside, like yeah, at yeah. his, like messing about in the field. And he'll like ride like he's 18 years old. Like he's like messing about like a kid and still loves it. And is still like, he's still got that like aggression and passion for it. He loves riding every second.
As good as it is for you to have him as a sort of mentor and stuff, it's probably like massively good for like keeping him young and like having, do you know what I mean? Like
it
works just, both ways.
He's like, honestly still like his mindset. He's still like he's 18 or 26, you know, he's still like me where every second he just wants to mess about on bikes and have fun doing it. And like that's exactly what I want to be like. Cause I always said it, I would stop racing if I didn't enjoy it. Mm-hmm. Like no matter where I am in my career, if I'm not enjoying it, I wouldn't be doing it anymore. There's just no point. And he still loves it. He still loves every second. He does not go away from the track as much as everybody thinks. He does not go away from the track and don't sit on a bike from next time. He's jumped on one. Like he'd be riding motocross one day. I'm not even going to say one day. He'd be riding motocross enduro in the morning and then we'd be in like flying about in go-karts all day and then doing something else, pit bikes, and then something else. Like just flat out and doing stuff because he just enjoys like racing about and like playing about with like quads in the field and like make a track and stuff like that. And just, he's still so passionate about it and rides still really hard. You know what I mean? It's not what you expect of like when I'm battling around with him on like pit bikes or something. You expect him to be like quite reserved, 50 years old. Honestly, he'd be like quite cautious. He's not. He'll like stick it like into the side of my bike, like full, like smash into me, like we're messing about on pit bikes, just like because that's what you do. And he's still got that in him, in the sense of like I still think he's going to be a man to watch out for. He's not done. He knows that Northwest still isn't the place to do it. He's a TT guy, not the Northwest guy. So he's got more experience than anyone out there. He's done more laps than anybody over 130 mile an hour. I'm sure he can knock them out for fun. So a couple of years out, I know it's not going to affect everybody too much, but certainly isn't going to affect him like that.
Mm-hmm. Aside from obviously picking John, is there anybody else that you think that people are maybe writing off or that you think is going to, like, is there anyone that you think is going to surprise people this year?
I don't know. There's a lot of guys, honestly, who are capable of being right up there. Michael Dunlop for sure is not done. Like he's still strong. Shorty still got pace. Hilly is going to be thereabouts. Hickey and Dean obviously are your top guys who everybody's watching out for. But then you can't ever write Connor off as well. Connor's been a solid podium man every time out. Mm. Everywhere we go, the Ulster Grand Prix. Yeah, he maybe didn't have the best Northwest, but he's still there or thereabouts. He knows that course. Oh, nobody spent a whole lot of time on the Isle of Man. He lives there. He's riding around all the time. Mm-hmm. Hutchie's still fast. He's still riding British Championship. He's going to be a man to watch out for. And then people like Dom, Dom's fast, like around the TT course. What was he last time? He was only one or two spots, two spots behind me. I think Jamie Coward was seventh, and he's
ninth or tenth in the senior. Yeah,
you know, he's there or thereabouts. He's not somebody people can write off. Like he says, he went top 20 in the all-time list at the Northwest. And honestly, I would say he's not the guy to watch at the Northwest. Northwest bodes for more like bit short circuit orientated people. I think come the TT, he's really going to shine as well. And Jamie Coward too. And like, man, it's honestly hard to think. Lee Johnson again, like people sort of... write him now into he's just a super sport guy, but like superstock race, he ended up on the podium, did he not? Second or third in the superstock race at the Northwest. He still knows how to ride a big bike. Like he's going to be there as well.
Yeah,
there's so many guys. Like it's really hard to
I am like mega looking forward to it. I've been out a couple of times for the TT, like a few days here and there, but this year I'm going out for the I got on the Monday of practice week, come back on the Sunday. I am missing the weekend in between because I've got to come back to the UK for that weekend, but yeah, mega looking forward to it. If there was like, say if you were taking a mate from home that like knows nothing about motorbike racing and you just wanted to say like put them somewhere on the course to watch to like experience the TT at its best, where would you suggest?
That's tough. There's a lot of spots. There is a lot.
Some I suppose you haven't spectated at many of it.
Not a lot for me. The thing that sold the TT for me was really simple. It was just after St. Ninian's Crossroads, just before the top of Bray Hill. And that's where I first ever actually watched the TT from in 2017, the first time I went there, the year before I raced there for the first time. I went and my mates took me, Tomby Vamos actually took me over there, and he took me there and I stood there and watched. It wasn't even the fast, like top guys. It was the guys like the back end of the field, maybe missed the front guys go through or something, or missed them set off and some later guys had come out, or it was certainly not the front running guys, and they come through there and I like, it just absolutely blew my mind. I was like, this is insane. You can hear them coming from like way up the road and then hear them go off into the distance, still flat out. And it just, the whole experience, feeling it through the ground, the bike go by you. And yeah, it's crazy when you see Bray Hill, how steep it is. And you know, they're just like going so fast. Oh, it's just a crazy thing to experience, and I've never got that feeling spectating in my life before. And for some reason, you get it at the TT. That's just, there's nothing like experiencing that. As well as there, I think Gorsley is a great spot there. Like there's a few spots in that and the next few miles that are just crazy fast corners that are just you. How people go around that quick, or like how we go around that quick, because even when I watched the Manx Grand Prix from there, I think the newcomers race, and spotted Pierre, the lad who actually ended up winning that super spot race, and he won the newcomers race there, and I couldn't believe how quick they were going, and they're like more than 10 mile an hour slower than what we were doing. And mm-hmm. I'm like in terms of lap times, the way slow around them corners or whatever, and it still just, you know, was insane. I couldn't get my head around it. So there's so many spots to name. Honestly, Black Dober gonna have a great spot to watch from.
Is that a plug for the go on plug the sponsor?
they're gonna have a great spot to watch from, and a bar and food and everything there.
Clothing.
But it is a great spot.
Yeah.
Like honestly, on the course, like I love riding through there, and they've took videos from there before, and it's a real cool spot.
Are you doing anything cool with Ugly and Co for the TT?
Yeah, so I'll be there a bunch of times over the course,
like signing sessions
TT.
And stuff.
It'd be cool. I'm gonna try and get there maybe for like a twin race or something, because I'm not be riding in that, but whether I'd be able to, I'm not sure yet. But yeah, I'll be there, make a few appearances up there, so it'd be really cool. Anyway, I'd just like to watch from there, because I've never had the chance to before.
Mm-hmm.
And then I've never even watched from there, but I went up to, there's a new cafe, Victory Cafe, and it's not a plug. I went up to that, and it just looks down on the bungalow. It's like where Joey's memorial is at the bungalow, and standing there, you can see a lot, like coming into the bungalow, going across the train track tram lines, and going back up the hill, up Hillwoods Rise. And I thought, like, to be honest, that would be a sick place to watch. Like, it would be really cool to get up there if I could to watch as well. So endless places, mate. It's just anywhere on that 38 mile course, it would be sick to watch from.
Yeah, and as well as obviously it is like the one of the greatest sort of spectacles on the planet, and as you said, like, it gives you such a high, but obviously with that you only sort of can get those ridiculous highs from the sort of inherent risk that's involved. And unfortunately, even though you've had such a short career so far at the TT, you've unfortunately been sort of you've seen that very, very close with losing one of, it was like your best mate, wasn't it? Like a daily teammate at the time as well, like so close, you were trained together close. Obviously it must be like so difficult at the event to kind of to box that off while you're on track and sort of get through it. Presumably it's must have been like really difficult.
Yeah, I won't beat around the bush. Yeah, like it was really difficult at the time, like sort of processing that and dealing with it. And then you're like, I'm racing tomorrow in another race, and you go out and continue. But like it's sort of understanding that, and thankfully, like in a sense, we'd like spoke about it before and spoke about you know, the risk that we're taking out there, and sat and talked about it, and we're like, you know, what if, like, you know, it does happen. I know the risk. And he's like, you know what? Like, we were both of the same mindset of like, we know the risks and we know what could happen, but you know what? Like, we still do it no matter what, because it is the best thing ever. The best thing you'll ever experience, bar nothing. Like, it is like a drug. It's addictive. Like, once you do it, I can't see you being able to stop doing it. Like, because it is such an amazing feeling that I've not had anything to be able to compare to that. So we both sat there and went, you know what, like, we know that feeling. So it's like, no matter the risk sort of thing, we're going to be doing it anyway. Like, it's, you know, something that you just got to keep doing, because it's a part of you once you start doing it. So it, yeah, damn right, it's so tough, like, dealing with that. But you know, I thought of it in my sense, and I wouldn't want anybody to think I wouldn't have wanted anything else if something happened to me.
Yeah, if it was like, vice versa, you'd 100%,
you know, I still want to do it no matter what, and I wouldn't want anybody else to stop because of me. Like, I want the race to carry on forever, because it is the best thing ever no matter what, because it's just unreal. So there's some sort of like peace in knowing that.
Mm-hmm, definitely. We've got last Patreon question. Darren Hughes, I've always been curious is the adrenaline rush of setting off down Bray Hill more the build up or actually when you're flying down? Don't know. I presume like building up to the things, like you must feel like so alive and like electric, like the focus must just be through the roof.
Building up to it, you don't feel alive, you feel damn nervous, like really nervous. There's nothing like it. It's like eerie almost, because it's a start line like you never get in any other race, where everybody's around and nobody's super jokey or like,
it's a serious business.
Other things, everybody's sort of down to business, where everybody's like really subdued, like on a TT start line, and you know, like your dad'll come over and tell you he loves you, and it's like you don't get that another race. Like, it's just there, like, and everybody's like, yeah, it's just a different feeling. So that's really weird, and you're super nervous and everything. Like, I get nervous at other races, like, I'm not scared to admit, like, you get nervous at other races, but you, like, once you're on the bike and moving forward, there's barriers, like two riders before the start, the actual start line where you get tapped on the shoulder. There's like two more bikes maybe in that space, and then another barrier where personnel can't go beyond that second barrier. So after that barrier, you're on your own sort of thing, and your guys would walk with you to that barrier. So you feel nervous right up until that barrier, and as soon as you get past it, everything seems to go away. And you just then like focus on what you're doing. It's, I've like explained it a few times, but it's super odd. Mm-hmm. And like, it's just the weirdest thing. Like, something switches in your brain and just goes, right, okay, like, we're about to start. Think about what's ahead. We're about to set off down Bray Hill. And you're just thinking about it, what you're going to do. Mm-hmm. So you're not actually thinking about being nervous and all. Like,
yeah, your mind's thinking occupied. About being nervous.
Yeah. All of a sudden, as soon as you get to that barrier, you're focused and thinking about the job at hand. So it sort of goes away. And then, yeah, the adrenaline starts. I mean, as soon as you set off, you're like, you go from stopped, obviously, to sixth gear flat out, like straight away. So it's just like a baptism of fire, isn't it? You're just like straight in.
Do you know from like a four lap or a six lap race, the from setting off, is there anything that you routinely change on the bike, like electronics or anything during the race, or do you just, is the bike exactly the same all the way through?
Yeah, I don't change nothing. Sometimes you would change things with the shock, usually wind in some more damping in a pit stop sometimes, because obviously the shock and suspension get super hot when you're out there, when you're out there riding. So it was something we did in the last pit stop on our suspension, is wind in a bit of damping, because it's like takes so much abuse, the shock, that it just overheats and loses a bit. So we did do that. But I'm really excited for this year because we've just started using K-Tech equipment in the bikes, and we got the K-Tech through rod shock. Another plug, but accidentally, but it is something I'm really excited about.
K-Tech last year.
Through rod shock, which I've never experienced before. This
Do you know
year.
How much they are, by the way?
Yeah, a lot. worth it.
Yeah. But with racing, it's one of them things where if it gives you a slight advantage, people can just write the check of like whatever it is, because like somebody will pay it if it is an advantage within the rules. But yeah, it's
and I don't think really there's anybody else doing it right now. So it's really cool. Anyway, we started using it here, but where it'll really shine and where the guys are really excited to see it shine is at the TT, because the main thing about it is that the feeling doesn't change with heat, with temperature building heat as it's moving, the feeling stays exactly the same, whereas another bike could, you know, start to move about more and the feeling would change. So
I had one last year, I think they're like about $5,000, aren't they?
Yeah, something like that. Four and a half.
It's bad.
It's a lot, but it's something that
it'd be worth it if you're on the podium.
Super important. Like you're coming in, it just all the way throughout that nearly 2 hour race, like something at BSB you can deal with for a couple of laps at the end you're starting to lose out, you might lose a couple of positions, but you can deal with it. Over the course of that race, it matters, like it's long. So like what is it, an hour 45 minutes or something, over the course of the full senior or six lap superbike race. So that will be cool, come into play, and it's something else that you don't have to worry about, something else that you don't have to be like, we need to remember, as hectic as a pit stop is, changing a visor, cleaning the screen so you can see out of it, changing the back wheel, any other adjustments that you want, also doing that adjustment to the shock. Like there's so much, and the less you do, there's less to go wrong at the end of the day.
Yeah.
So they can just focus on that and not have to worry about it. So.
And just to wrap things up, do you know, it's like John talks about it all the time, and it's in like his book and whatever, and like I've heard him speak about it at like chat shows or interviews or whatever, but he's got like a very distinct ritual before he goes away at the TT, with like, he like moves his grass and like gets everything like lined up. Do you have any sort of like any rituals that you do before leaving?
Nah, not at all. Don't really do any of that. I want to say superstitious stuff, but a little superstitious thing of like this little cross necklace that I actually got tattooed on my arm, because every time I've not wore it, I've like fell off or something like that over the course of like the last 5 years or something.
Where did that come from?
I got a necklace with a cross on from my mate like years ago, and I started wearing it, and then I don't know, one time I just didn't wear it and I fell off, and I was like, that's why. And I'm like, it's rubbish, and I don't believe in superstitious things, but also I'd rather just wear it just in case.
Why?
And get it tattooed on my arm in case we get it, but I'm not sure that works. Okay. I'd just rather wear it.
Yeah. Mega. Well, like I say, it's been really weird sitting and doing the podcast without Dom, but this podcast is going to go out on the Sunday as the TT starts. So obviously it's been... we talk about it every week, but like everyone's like so buzzing about it. And for yourself, like I obviously wish you all the very best. And as we've talked about, like sort of perfect setup and just kind of keep chipping away. You know, we've got like a long career, and just like I'm sure you'll get stuck in and sort of do your best. So yeah, all the best. And massive thank you. Obviously, good luck for this weekend as well, but we'll just kind of get this out of the way and get the TT. Massive thanks to our sponsors, Colchester Kawasaki, to all of our patrons. And yeah, next podcast, we haven't got anybody lined up for it, like at the TT, but we'll this trailer is going over, as long as it doesn't get pinched this weekend. This trailer is going to be over in the paddock, so Croy's taking that over, and we'll get a few podcasts booked in. So yeah, all the best, mate.
I need to plug for some sponsors for aircon or something like that, because hot in here.
I know that we have actually got a thingy, but yeah, we usually can open the door, but the our friends that burgled it the other day, I've sawn the lock off, so we actually drove here with that duct taped.
Oh, nice.
But yeah, I'll get that fixed this weekend. But yeah, all the best, and yeah, I look forward to watching your trackside over in a couple of weeks.
Can't wait, mate.
Have you got anything, by the way, before we wrap, have you got any like things to plug? Like, you sell your merchandise to Ugly & Co, don't you?
Merch is on shredmag.co. So that we just released at the Northwest, so that's really cool. We should have some at the TT. Awesome. I'm just excited to go racing.
So is that shredmag.co.uk?
No, shredmag.co.
All right.
Yeah. It's cooler. Different. Like that.
Yeah, yeah.
Shredmag.co.
And what we've got, caps, t-shirts, that sort of thing?
Yeah, some caps, beanies. Hopefully we won't need beanies because it's just going to be so hot and sunny. For definitely the TT anyway, I hope. Tees, like, got some cool like long sleeve tees or three quarter sleeve tees, some hoodies, stuff like that. But yeah, I'm excited. Go buy one.
Yeah, class. And on socials, it's just like at Davey Todd 74.
Yep.
Yeah, excellent. Right, we'll catch up soon and look after yourself. Cheers.
Mega, cheers, dude.
Chasing the Racin. Powered by Colchester Kawasaki, part of the Global Moto Group. We supply new Aprilia, Moto Guzzi, Vespa, Royal Enfield, Kawasaki, Sim, Mutt, and Benelli motorcycles.